I want to turn our attention a little bit to the mechanics of prayer, if you will, the logistics of it, how it works, how we do it. And I want to guide you in that direction by asking you a question. How did you learn to pray? Who taught you? Maybe you read a book after you became a follower of Jesus that kind of spelled out, here's how, you know, prayers are supposed to go, here's what they're supposed to look like. Maybe you listened to a sermon that kind of unpacked the details of a fulfilling and satisfying prayer life. Maybe you had a spiritual mentor who guided you in that process and helped you figure out how to talk to your Father in heaven because it was something new and strange for you. Maybe you learned as a kid. How many of you learned to pray as kids? That's a lot of you. Maybe your parents held your hands at night as you prayed in your bed before you went to sleep. They knelt down next to you and you thanked God for everything from the cookies you had for a snack to your grandparents or whatever. The prayers of children are cute, I think. Then again, maybe you don't really know how to pray. And that works itself out in that you just feel uncomfortable doing it. You've been told that people who talk to themselves are crazy, and that feels too much like talking to yourself, and so you just don't do it that much. Most of us probably learn to pray by watching other people do it, right? We're human beings, we're mimics. We learn our skills through imitation. We watch somebody do something, and then we do our best to parrot their activity. And so maybe that's how you learn to pray. You just watched the people around you who prayed, and you picked up on to-dos and not-to-dos in all of that stuff. I learned to pray by watching my family do it. As I was a child, we went to church often, not always, but often. And I learned to pray by spending time just watching my parents and my grandparents do it. Family prayers in the Fergus household usually happened around the table, you know, especially at family gatherings. I remember my parents not making a huge deal about prayer when I was a little kid, but when the entire clan McFergus was around, you know, they rolled out the big flowery prayers and got down to business that way. I remember that prayer in my home was more ritualistic than conversational. And by that, I don't mean sincere. I just mean that we spent a lot of time reciting memorized prayers. God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for this food. Amen. Yeah, that was one that got said at most meals. The bedtime prayer was one that actually terrified me. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Some of you are reciting that with me, right? Yeah. Try going to sleep as a child with thoughts of impending death in your head. That is a terrifying prospect. I don't know who came up with that prayer, but I'm certain it was a bad joke. That's what I am sure of. Here's some lessons that I learned about prayer from my family. Prayer was something that you needed to hurry up and get out of the way so you could get to the good stuff, like eating my great-grandmother's fried chicken. Oh, it was good. So we prayed quickly so that we could dig into those mountains of fried chicken. Prayer, for some reason, required strange words. Words like blessing and fellowship. Words we didn't use for anything else in my house except prayer time. Here's the most important thing I learned about prayer from my family. Prayers are best when they rhyme. I've lost my ability to do that. Now, please don't think as I talk about these prayer lessons that I learned from my family that I am in any way criticizing my family and their prayers when I was a kid. I wouldn't do that. I think they did the best that they knew how. And besides, I don't think my family is all that different from other families when it comes to prayer. You know, we kind of stumble through this a little bit together and try to figure it out. By and large, we learn to pray by watching the people around us who pray. That's how we pick it up. And if our examples, our prayer examples, aren't very helpful, then prayer can be kind of a confusing thing for us. Apparently, Jesus' disciples, the 12, the first followers of Christ, had learned to pray from some confusing prayer examples. And so Jesus thought that before he taught them how to pray, he needed to undo some teaching. And I know that because he lays all that out for us in Scripture. Let me show you this. If you would, this evening, open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6. Find verse 5. We're smack dab in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount here, and Jesus is going to teach his followers how to pray. Matthew 6, verse 5. But in order to tell them the right way to do it, he's got to undo some things. He wants to help them get down to the mechanics, the logistics of here's how you pray. But first, he's got to get some of those confusing examples out of the way. And we see that in verse 5, where Jesus says this to them. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues, at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Jesus says, when you pray, don't pray like the hypocrites. Apparently, some of Jesus' followers had learned how to pray from the hypocrites. Now, Jesus probably has corrupt religious leaders in his sights when he says that. People who have turned prayer into a performance. People who prayed for the expressed and maybe solitary purpose of impressing the people around them. In fact, what we know about these folks is that these people whom Jesus is talking about, he calls them hypocrites, they would purposefully position themselves, arrange their schedules around the Jewish daily prayer times. Check their clocks. Oh, at 12 o'clock, I'll be right in the middle of a large crowd. Perfect. That's prayer time. And so they could say, excuse me just a moment. I know you're busy, but I've got to pray first. As a demonstration of their own personal piety and holiness. They were working their schedules so that when it came time to pray, they would be in the most conspicuous places. Jesus mentions street corners. They're out in public, in the streets. Excuse me just a moment. You know, your story's interesting, but... And then they would pray as a demonstration, again, of their own personal piety. Prayer was a performance to these people. They were actors. That's what the word hypocrite means. Somebody who acts. Have you ever been around people who have turned prayer into a performance? An opportunity to demonstrate or display their own personal piety to the people around them? I don't want to get too critical of anybody here because I am sure that I have slipped into bad habits at points in my life as well. But I remember early in my ministry, I met this man who was a good guy, really kind of, you know, sharp around the edges, profane in his speech, swore like a sailor, to be honest with you. No offense, sailors. That's an expression, right? But when it came time to pray, this was the strangest thing in the world. When it came time to pray, all of a sudden his uncouth and harsh language would miraculously turn into polished King James English. Lots of these and thous and thines and doists, and I think he was just making stuff up. I think he was just putting ests on other things, and it was just the strangest thing I had ever seen in my life. Prayer was something of a performance. I don't want to question the guy's sincerity because I don't know what was going on in his head, but it was clear that he was turning something on when it came time to pray, that he was making it a performance. Jesus doesn't want prayer to be that way for his followers, right? So he's got to undo that a little bit. Tells us, don't do that. Don't don't make prayer a performance to demonstrate your piety. And in order to safeguard against that, Jesus encourages his followers to pray in secret to their Father, who sees them praying in secret. Now, it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with public prayer. Jesus is just trying to take the focus off of prayer as a performance and move it to prayer as sincere conversation with our Father. So he had to undo that. He had to undo that confusing prayer example. That's not the only example that he's got to undo here in Matthew chapter 6. When we pick it up in verse 7, we see that some of Jesus' followers had apparently learned how to pray from frantic pagan Gentiles. Listen to this, verse 7. "And when you pray," Jesus says, "do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him." And we know something about the way these pagan Gentiles worshiped at that time. We know some of the prayers. We found some of their written prayers. And we know that these pagans would try to wear out their gods, break them down with many words. They would say prayers a certain magic number of times, you know, maybe to get the god to pay attention to them. They would pile up all of the names of the god, hoping that one of them would catch the god's attention so that god would then turn and perhaps grant their request or whatever. As if a secret name was the little tone on the god's phone that told him he had a new message that he needed to check. You know, like that. And they would just heap up their words. Jesus says they would just pile them on. Elijah's confrontation with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel is a really good example of this. Do you remember that story? Elijah is confronting the prophets of Baal. It's in 1 Kings chapter 18. I want to read just a section of this to you. Elijah is challenging the prophets of the Baal of Tyre to a duel, if you will. And in verse 25, here's how it goes. The prophets are imploring their God. They're crying out to him. There's 450 of these guys just shouting out to their God in prayer. And here's what we read, verse 25. "Then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, 'Choose for yourselves one bull and prepare it first, for you are many, and call upon the name of your God, but put no fire to it.'" And you know the contest. If their God lights it on fire miraculously, he's God. "Then Elijah will do the same thing." And of course, Elijah wins this contest. But look at how it plays out. 1 Kings 18, 26. "And they," those are the pagan Gentile prophets, "they took the bull that was given them, and they prepared it and called upon the name of Baal from morning until noon." It's a long time. "From morning until noon, saying, 'O Baal, answer us.' But there was no voice, and no one answered. And they limped around the altar that they had made." Verse 27, "And at noon, Elijah mocked them, trash-talked them, saying, 'Cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is musing, or he is relieving himself.'" Yes, that's exactly what that means, by the way. "Or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is asleep and must be awakened." Elijah is taunting them a little bit. Verse 28, "And they cried aloud and cut themselves after their custom with swords and lances until the blood gushed out upon them. And as a midday passed, they raved." Oh, wow. "They raved on until the time of the offering of the oblation. But there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention." I'm struck by verse 29. They raved, begged, screamed, cried out to their God to answer them. They had to rave to get his attention. And Jesus is telling us in Matthew chapter 6, we don't have to do that. We don't have to rave to God. We don't have to beg him for his attention. Do you know why? He's already watching us. We already have his attention. Some people in their prayers carry on in, you know, pristine, holy roller fashion, trying to impress God with flowery words, trying to gain his attention, trying to heap up words, pile on every name they can think of. We don't have to do that. We don't have to rave. Because our Heavenly Father knows what we need even before we ask him. That's what Jesus says right here in this passage. We've already got his attention. So rather than leave his disciples with these negative examples of prayer, Jesus then begins to give them a good example of, here's what a prayer can look like. And you know this passage. It's the Lord's Prayer. I bet you could recite this out loud too. Pray then like this, Jesus says. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The earliest manuscripts don't have the next part, but I have to say it because that's how I memorized it as a kid. For thine, I got to throw a thine in there. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And so, you know this passage. This is the Lord's Prayer. This is Jesus helping his followers understand how they can pray and discuss life with their Father. It's not a ritualistic prayer. It's not the only way to pray. It's not something that we have to do. Jesus is just sharing a basic prayer that contains the important elements of how to talk to God. Now, I'm not interested in unpacking every single one of these elements with you this evening. We might have an opportunity to do that in the coming weeks or months or whenever I have this chance to speak to you again. But for now, what I want us to focus on in our remaining time is just the general approach to prayer that Jesus is suggesting. Because that's what he's tackling here, really. He's denounced two approaches to prayer. The first one being prayer as a performance. The other being raving prayer to an inattentive God. He's dealt with those. What he wants to do now is help us understand the way followers of Jesus, lovers of God, pray. And it's all in the approach. It's all in the approach. Because what we see in this passage that we just read is that primarily, first and foremost, Jesus wants us to approach prayer as a conversation with our Heavenly Father. That's it. That's how he wants us to frame it intellectually. It's not a performance. We're not begging to a God who doesn't care. Those approaches are erroneous. They are false. They don't apply to our God. Jesus wants us to think of prayer as talking with our Father. Now, twice in this passage already, and then here again in verse 9, Jesus calls God Father. You saw it, right? Talk to your Father who sees in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Pray like this, Father. He wants us to talk to God as our Father. Now, you and I do that, don't we? That's the word we use when we're talking to him. We call him Father. And so this is not necessarily as revolutionary to us as it would have been to the first followers of Jesus. But I want us to try to step back in time with him just a little bit and see the amazing invitation that Jesus is extending here. Because what Jesus is inviting us to do is to call God our Father. This would have been a remarkable idea to the first hearers of Jesus' words. In fact, it might have made some of them kind of uncomfortable to talk about God with that level of intimacy. Why? Well, because God is only called Father 15 times in the entire Old Testament. That's a bunch of the Bible. That's that much of the Bible. In those many pages, God is only called Father 15 times. And even some of those references are to metaphors or analogies of God is like a father. But to call him father, that's a rare occurrence. The people of Israel are called children often. But God isn't called father. Just 15 times in the entire Old Testament. Compare that to the 245 times God is called father in that much of your Bible. And you'll see that this is a remarkable thought for these folks. In 245 times, God is called father in the New Testament. And like I said, this when Jesus brings this to their attention and encourages them to adopt this approach to talk to God as father, as their approach to prayer, this would have been new. Might have made them a bit uncomfortable. I remember when I was a Bible college student a long time ago in Southern California, I was in a course on the Gospel of Luke, and my professor would invite different students to open the class in prayer, you know, performance time, here you go, room full of future pastors, yeah. But this one guy prayed. I remember his name was Jeff, and probably still is Jeff, and it was Jeff's turn to pray, and Jeff asked us to bow our heads, and he said, "Daddy, we thank you so much for this," and he went on, and I thought, "Daddy, that's a little intimate, isn't it? It's a little familiar, maybe a little uncomfortable, it'll probably make you uncomfortable. If I prayed to our heavenly daddy tonight, you would have been like, what? That's how uncomfortable some of these first hearers probably would have been. To talk to God with that kind of familiarity and intimacy would have been a new idea to them. And like I said, for some of them, it might have even seemed inappropriate, a bit disrespectful, if you will. But that's the approach that Jesus calls us to take to prayer. Do you see how calling God Father would have changed prayer for these first folks that Jesus spoke to? Some of them were laboring under the delusion that God was an inattentive God who had to be appeased, or that maybe God was only interested in flowery, showy displays of religiosity. Jesus is saying, you don't have to do that. You don't have to think like that. You can just talk to them. Talk to him the way you would talk to your father. God is our father. That's a game changer. You and I are 2,000 years removed from this game changer, but let's allow it to change our game, our prayer game tonight. Because what Jesus is inviting us to do is to think about God as our Father. Now, with that invitation, we've got to try to figure out what is he really inviting us to when he invites us to call God Father? Because notions of fatherhood are slippery things, aren't they? My understanding of fatherhood, my image of fatherhood has been, you know, largely impacted by my experience with my own earthly father. So has yours. So has yours. And that comes with its own set of baggage. I love my dad. I get to see him next week. He's coming out for my oldest daughter is graduating from high school. I'm not ready for this, but it's happening. And so my dad and stepmom are coming out for that, and my youngest son is promoting out of eighth grade. That's a big deal. My middle daughter, Tess, who is here tonight and lovely as always, tells me, and I'm going to be a junior in high school. So we're celebrating that as well because we can't leave Tess out. I love my dad, but growing up, in my growing up years, things were a little bit difficult. I love him, I believe he loves me, but when I was a young child, he was not very present in my life. My father left our family when I was 9 years old. And as a result, I always kind of thought of him, and I didn't have a whole lot of contact with him for a lot of years. I always thought of him as somebody who loved me, but maybe wasn't all that interested. in me or what was going on in my life, because if he was interested, then he would make some effort to demonstrate that interest. That image has affected my image, my understanding of God as my Father. I don't want it to. But sometimes I see God as a Father who loves me, but is maybe a bit uninvolved in my life. And I fight against that. I'm like, no, that's not how my Heavenly Father is. That's not how he is. I wrestle against that. And I am sure that if you took your image of your earthly father and held it up in comparison to your own personal image of your Heavenly Father, you would probably see similarities and points of contact. It wouldn't be one-to-one, but you would find those kinds of issues. And so when we talk about God as Father, we import all of that, don't we? So the question that we really have to deal with is this. When Jesus encouraged these first hearers to call God Father, what was he suggesting? What would have been their image of fatherhood 2,000 years ago in a culture vastly different from ours? What would have the Hebrew idea of father been for these first hearers? It's an important question. And what we know is that fatherhood would have carried two very important implications for these folks. Let me just quickly unpack both of those for you, because that's what Jesus is inviting us to. As order of first business, calling God Father would have been Jesus' way of reminding his first hearers and us, by way of extension, of our dependence on God. He would have been saying, when you call God Father, you think of what that means. And what that means is that God is our provider. Tell you why I know that's the case. First century children in the Middle East were the most vulnerable people in society. They were powerless social dependents. They had no ability to stand up for themselves. They had no other source of provision to turn to except their parents. And it was the father in a family who was the provider. And so this notion of fatherhood to first century children would have been, that's the guy who makes it so that I can eat. That's the guy who makes it so that I can live. He is the provider. That's why the New Testament, James chapter 1, verse 27, frames the most vulnerable members of society as widows and orphans. Because if there's no father in a family, there's nobody to provide the basic daily needs of this family. Folks back then didn't have a social safety net that the most vulnerable members of society could rely on if things went horribly bad. That's why Jesus encounters beggars in the gospel. Because if there wasn't a father in the home, there wasn't somebody to provide, and you had to get out there in the town square with your hand out and hope that people would, just out of the kindness of their hearts. So with that said, regardless of what we import into the image of fatherhood, when Jesus invites us to call God Father, he's inviting us to recognize how much we need God. He's inviting us to remember that God is the one who provides. We pray to God as Father because he's the only one who can meet our needs. He's the provider. Praying to anybody else is pointless. Doesn't work. It's not necessary. Only God can come through for us when it comes to the most important things in life. That's the first thing that Father would have brought to their mind. Father as provider. God is our provider. The second thing that would have come to these people's minds as they hear the word Father is probably more in line with what we would like to think of when we hear the word Father. Calling God Father would also have reminded them, and it reminds us, of our intimate relationship with God. He's our Father. Unlike the raving pagan Gentiles who had to beg their God for just a hint of help, our God is aware of our needs, and he cares very much. In fact, he loves us very much. And so our prayers aren't some kind of complex ritual designed to manipulate God into giving us what we need. Our Father knows what we need. He wants to be there for us, and He understands our vulnerability, guarantees that He will provide, and is just waiting. And so the approach to prayer that Jesus suggests then is not, you know, us raving to try to get God's attention. The approach is simply, you know, that our prayers are just cries of need in faith to a God who can meet those needs, a God who hears us, a God who loves us intimately. Here's what I want you to hear tonight. We pray to a providing, loving, and attentive Father. And that's the approach that Jesus wants us to take. We don't have to earn God's favor through ritualized prayer. Prayer doesn't have to be a performance that impresses God or the people around us. We pray as an expression of trust in a Father who already knows our needs. He's apparently just waiting for us to recognize our dependence on Him and ask Him. Because we're reminded that we don't have because we don't ask. Who knows? He might drop a $100 bill in your front yard. Is that the craziest story? Oh my goodness. The key is using it for why he dropped it there. That's the important part. Yeah. So what do we do with all of this? How does this information that we've learned from the scriptures tonight, how does it impact our prayer lives? Well, some of us are probably going to have to work at overcoming some confusing examples of prayer. Things, ways we've been taught, things we've learned. I have gotten over the need to rhyme all of my prayers, but I still think that's pretty snappy. So apparently I still have some work to do in that. Some of us are going to have to get past some unfortunate examples of fatherhood. And I don't say that to shame anybody. I think about myself as a father, and I know I've tried hard to do my best, and I know that my kids will, well, they're going to need counseling. There's just no doubt about it. I'll pay for it. So, but we're going to have to overcome those images, and we're going to have to remember that God is not like that. God is a perfect Father, full of love and grace and wisdom and justice and righteousness, all of the things that you would want. That's who He is. And He encourages us to call Him that because He wants that intimacy with us. That's the approach. It's not a performance. It's not a ritual. It's a relationship. Jesus wants us to approach prayer as a conversation with our Heavenly Father. We don't have to beg Him to pay attention to us. He already knows what we need. We don't have to worry about doing it right. That's a thing. We don't have to worry about doing it right. Here's what this passage tells us. Here's what this approach to prayer helps us understand. We can depend upon our Father. We can depend upon Him. He will provide. He loves us. And He knows what we need. And that was a game changer for these folks. And we need to allow it to impact our hearts the way it would have impacted them. Praying to God as our Father reminds us that He is our provider and that He is our intimate Father. So let's talk to Him. Let's talk to our Father. And then we'll spend a little bit more time worshiping Him together this evening. Lord, I thank You so much for this evening and the opportunity You've given us to open Your word and study it and consider what it has to say to our lives. I am so encouraged by this newfangled approach that Jesus suggests to prayer, talking to You as our Father, our provider, our intimate Father, the one who loves us and wants to be close to us. Lord, we come to You tonight. Some of us have light hearts and are celebrating things in life, things like high school graduations or college graduate or whatever. Some of us come with full hearts ready to celebrate. Some of us come with heavy hearts. Lord, we know that You already know our needs. That's what Jesus said. We We don't have to rave because you already know what we need. So, Lord, as we come to you tonight with our hearts, be they full or empty and hurting, we are confident that you know what we need, that you can provide what we need. And Lord, as we approach you tonight, not as a God who has to be appeased or a God interested in performance, as we approach you tonight as our intimate Father, we pray that you would meet us where we need. Hear the cries of our hearts and comfort us with the fact that you are our Father in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.